Welcome to the Sunday evening service of Ambassador Baptist Church. We're delighted you're with us this evening. We had a good service this morning, enjoyed the moving of the Lord, and so we're hopeful that you'll be with us tonight. I believe we got some of our kinks worked out in our live stream from the auditorium. Next week, we'll move the camera a little closer so that we have more focus on the platform and not the whole auditorium. This evening, we're going to finish up the study that we've been doing on prayer. So if you have your Bibles there with you, if you'll turn to Matthew chapter number 26. Now, last week, we looked at an unsafe prayer that was prayed by David in Psalms 139. But tonight, we're going to look at another unsafe prayer and challenge you and encourage you to pray this prayer. We all know how frustrating it is when something we cherish is broken. Whether it's a child's favorite toy or a cherished item in our home, or maybe it's an everyday object like the garage door or a plate or a broken window, or in our case, your pickup truck, all the way up to broken bones, broken relationships, and even broken hearts. And we don't like broken things. Whether you believe it or not, super glue and duct tape can't fix everything. Don't let MacGyver know that. But today we're going to talk about what it means to be broken. To do that, we're going to look at a passage in Matthew chapter 26. We're going to talk about what it means to be broken, then spend some time considering what it means in our lives as individuals. This is the final message of the series that we've been looking at for the last several weeks on prayer. We looked at David's life last week, Psalm 139, when David asked God to search his heart. That's an unsafe prayer because you may not like what God reveals to you. Nonetheless, we need to ask God to search our hearts so that we can rid our lives of those things that don't need to be there. And as difficult as last week's might be, because it was pretty vulnerable when you asked God to search your heart. Now, God knows all about you. God knows your heart. But tonight we're going to look at a prayer that we may not want to pray. This morning we talked about cleaning out our prayer closets. We talked about really praying for one another. That's a command that God has given us in the scriptures. But tonight, our prayer, it's not a safe one. It's not a comfortable one. It may not even feel good to pray it. But I'm going to ask you to consider what it means to be broken. And even to make that our prayer. I want you to consider praying this very unsafe prayer. Now, not all of you will. You don't have to pray this, but this very well may change your life and your relationship with God. So let's get into the meat of the message. Jesus was gathered with his closest friends, his disciples. They're eating together, and Jesus knows that this is his last meal. Now, the disciples, they don't have a clue as to what's going on or what's going to unfold later on. But Jesus knows that this is going to be very painful, very shameful, and very humiliating. And so really what he's doing here is he's in the process of saying goodbye to the men that he has come to love very deeply because he's about to give his life on the cross for your sins and my sins. And so in Matthew chapter 26, verse 26, 27, and 8, the Bible says, "And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.' And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, 'Drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins.'" And so what did Jesus say about his body and his blood? He said, "This is my body broken for you. This is my blood that is poured out for you." And so his body was broken and blood poured out. It was a sacrifice for everyone because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And so his body was broken for you. His blood was poured out for you. Now, understand that the Greek word for poured out means to gush out, to literally shed, or greedily spill. This is not the image of a few drops. It's an image of all of his blood, not a token donation, but everything poured out, given for many. Now, hold on to that thought for just a minute, because just prior to this story, a little earlier in Matthew chapter 26, we read this story. Now, when Jesus was in Bethany, verse 6, 7, and 8, now when Jesus was in Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, there came unto him a woman having an alabaster box of very precious ointment, and poured it out on his head as he sat at meat. But when the disciples saw it, they had indignation, saying, to what purpose is this waste? Now, let's set the stage in this story, because you think about it, where was Jesus? He was in the home of Simon the leper. Now, how would you like to have that for a nickname? Who would have been seen with a leopard back in that day? Well, Jesus would have. He's hanging out with sinners. You and I need to get along and hang out with some sinners and share the gospel with them, like God has commanded us to do. He wasn't partaking in their sin. He was sharing the gospel with them. Some believe this woman was a prostitute. In all honesty, we really don't know who she is. All we know is that this woman took a year's worth of wages and broke it open and poured it on Jesus. Now, somewhere along the way, this woman found that she was valued, respected, and that she was honored by Jesus. She experienced the power of God's love through Jesus Christ. Maybe it was the first time she'd ever felt loved, but in that transformation, it transformed her, and she wanted to worship Jesus in the most sacrificial way that she could imagine. Her extravagant act of worship totally confused everyone in this story except Jesus. Now, you imagine taking a year's worth of income, putting that amount in a bottle, and then pouring it out on someone. Boom, it's gone in a flash. It's gone. She's got this incredibly expensive perfume, and she breaks it open, and she pours it over Jesus' head. Now, some of the people there, they freaked out. Some of the people that were there, they were furious. How could she do that? Why would she do that? Maybe put a drop or two on his head, but not the entire body. But you have to understand, secondly, this was an act of worship which was more extravagant than you can ever imagine. Essentially, what she is saying is, I'm giving you my whole life. I'm giving you the most valuable possession that I have. This represents my past and my future. So in other words, she says, I'm leaving my past life. I'm giving my future source of income and my life savings away. Jesus, you loved me and you changed me, so I will break open the most valuable possession that I have. You get all of it. Not a donation, not a token drop or two, but all of me is given you in this perfume. And so my jar is broken in an act of worship, and I pour it all out because I'm giving you everything I am and everything that I have. And so it was broken and it was poured out. Now, if we go back to the Last Supper there, that where we began, Luke was there at the Last Supper as well, and he reported what Jesus did, but he said something that Mark didn't. In Luke chapter 22 and verse number 19, he took the bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave unto them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. And so Luke basically said the same thing. Jesus took bread, he gave thanks, he broke it, he gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Then notice what he says. He says, this do in remembrance of me. Do this in remembrance of me. What is this? Well, most of us would agree that as followers of Jesus, we gather together and we take the Lord's Supper. We take the bread and we take the cup, and we do this in remembrance of him. We celebrate the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's what we do in remembrance of him. That's what it means, do this in remembrance of me. We look back to Calvary. We look back to when Christ died on the cross. We look back to his resurrection, and we remember that. So when we go through communion, when we do communion, do we just go through the motions? Or is there something more to communion? Could it be that when Jesus said, "This do in remembrance of me," just as Jesus was broken and was poured out, just as this woman broke open her bottle and poured it out on Jesus, maybe the call in our lives should lead us to do the very same thing as well. Maybe it's time that we pray that God would break us, that God would allow us to remember what he went through, and that he would break us so that we might be broken and poured out for him, that we might live as he lived. God calls us to live as Jesus lived. God calls us to love as Jesus loved. So maybe this is showing us that we're to die to ourselves daily so that we can live for the glory of God. Bible says, whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all to the glory of God. So when the gospel says to do this, what if perhaps Jesus was saying, don't just do an act to remembrance, but may you also be broken and poured out in the same way. Even as Paul said in Philippians 2:17, yea, and if I be offered upon the sacrifice and service of your faith, I joy and rejoice with you all. In other words, I'm poured out like a drink offering. I'm broken and I'm poured. Sacrifice. Jesus said that we were to present our bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is our reasonable service. And so as we consider the story of the woman who broke her bottle and poured her perfume over Jesus, and as we consider Jesus who was broken and poured out for you and I, could it be that we too are called to be broken and poured out in the name of Jesus? When was the last time that your heart was broken, that you poured yourself out to God in prayer, asking God to take care of someone or something, or to bring you back to him, to repent of your sins? Could it be that we are called to be broken and poured out in the name of Jesus? Could that be our prayer? Could that be your prayer? Lord, what is it I need to be broken from? What is it I need to pour out of my life? How can my spirit be poured out because of you? You consider what God is calling you to be broken of. There are so many things that we could say. How can your life be like Paul's, as he referred to himself in Philippians chapter 2 and verse 17, as being poured out for God? How can we imitate Paul? How can we imitate Christ? So this could be the most dangerous prayer for you to pray, praying and asking God to break you and to pour you out. Now, if you're serious, your life may be forever different. If you get a hold of this, it's not a safe prayer, but it could be the most liberating prayer that you will ever pray. And so asking God to break you and to pour you out, for him and for his service and for his glory and for his honor. And so as you consider what you need to be broken of, maybe it's self-centeredness, maybe it's pride, maybe it's ego, or maybe it's lust or greed, or maybe you have a problem with covetousness or jealousy or envy. You name it, it's out there. And so what is it in your life? Maybe it's a pet sin that you need to be broken of. You need to pray and ask God to break you of whatever it is. Then you know what it is. I know what it is in my life. You know what it is in your life. You just need to come before God and ask him to break you of it. And then as you consider what you need to pour out, maybe it's that you need to get involved in church to serve. Maybe you don't serve, but you need to. Maybe you need to pour out and get involved in the church financially. You say, well, others will do it. I don't need to. Maybe you need to pour out. Maybe you need to pour out to pray. Maybe you need to pour out to read your Bible. Maybe you need to pour out to help others, or maybe to give up your anger and your bitterness. I don't know what it is in your life that you need to pour out, but I promise you, if you pray and ask God and seek him and ask him to break you and to pour you out, I promise you that God will hear and answer that prayer. And so today we need to pray and ask God, Lord, what is it in my life that I need to be broken of? What is it in my life that needs to be poured out for your honor and for your glory? And so some will not want to pray that prayer because God may ask them to do something or break them of something that they're not ready to give up yet, or that's something that needs to be poured out that they're not willing to do. This morning we talked about cleaning out our prayer closet and getting distractions and all those things out of the way so that we can come together alone with God to pray and to pray for one another. But also ask God in your closet, God, what is it in my life that I need to be broken up? What it is in my life that needs to be poured out? Maybe for yourself, maybe for your family, maybe to be a blessing to someone else. But remember what we said this morning, that when we go to God in our prayer closet and we pray in secret, God then will reward publicly and in open. And so today it may be you just need this week to get in your closet and to seek God's face and ask Him, God, what is it in my life that needs to be broken? What is it in my life that needs to be poured out? You remember that God died on Calvary's tree. He was broken. He was wounded for you and for your transgressions, and His blood was spilt and shed for your sin. And so today, what is it that we can be broken of and poured out that we might bring honor and glory to God? If you're here today watching and you've never trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, He died for your sins. He shed His blood to pay a debt that He didn't know, but He paid your sin debt. And if you will come to Him and ask Him and confess to Him that you're a sinner, ask Him to forgive you of your sins and to cleanse you, He will do that. And then ask Him, invite Him to come into your life and save you. Call upon Him. And the Bible says that He will hear you and He will answer you and He will forgive you of your sins and come into your life and He will save you. Then He will put your name in the Lamb's Book of Life and He will give you eternal life. If you're here today watching and you're saved, why not ask God what it is in your life that you need to be broken of and what it is in your life that needs to be poured out? And then listen. Listen to the Holy Spirit of God as those things are revealed. That's why this is, I call it an unsaved prayer. You may not be willing to listen and to do those things, but God will tell you if you ask Him. And then when you do that, it will draw you into a greater, more honoring, and more powerful relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. So I encourage you today to pray that prayer and to seek and to ask, and then when God reveals, to follow what He says to do. Our Heavenly Father, we love You today. We're grateful and thankful for our Savior that was broken and poured out for our salvation. We're thankful for this woman that broke this expensive perfume and poured out on Him to show her love and her worship of Him, to be willing to give her all to Him. I pray tonight that You will help us, that we might be broken and poured out, willing to give and to sacrifice our all on the altar and to make ourselves a living sacrifice that would be holy and acceptable unto Christ, and not being conformed to this world, but being transformed by the renewing of our minds. And we'll be careful to give You all the honor and glory and praise for it, because we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Well, God bless you this evening. Thank you for joining us here on our live stream. We will be back this Wednesday night, beginning to continue looking at the book of Revelation, beginning chapter number 14. And so I hope you will come and join us and be a part of that. May God bless you. May you have a great week.